You're next in line for the official Holiday World podcast.
Welcome to Holiday World and Splash and Safari.
Dropping in from Santa Claus, Indiana.
Riders will experience swift acceleration, high-speed turns, and sudden stops.
Now stow your loose articles, buckle up.
And please keep your hands and legs inside the car at all times.
And we are back. It's a new year for the Holiday World, the official Holiday World podcast. This is episode 024. Today is Wednesday, January Wednesday, right?
Yes.
We're all so confused. We had two glorious weeks off.
It was amazing.
We don't know what day it is.
Nope.
And I saw something. It was a meme on Facebook. So many memes. But something about the week between Christmas and New Year's where no one knows what day it is and everyone eats too much cheese.
Cheese.
And I just thought, cheese.
That's oddly specific.
But it's
but oddly accurate.
It is, because yeah. Everybody does those cheese. Hideous cheese balls for Christmas Day,
hideous.
Right? Hideous.
Stop.
Do you want the rest of mine?
Sure.
Okay. I've picked all the almonds off the outside.
Oh,
so.
No. It's just it looks like I've munched on.
It'll look like bait from the mousetrap or something. And the title of this episode is The One with the Prodigal Oboe. Look who's back. It's
hey.
Leah Cook.
Hey.
This is exciting. I am Paula with our pod squad, Lauren, Eric, and Leah. Matt will be back in 2 weeks. He wasn't able to make it this morning, but we do welcome Leah back.
Thanks.
And thank you.
Glad
apparently,
to be back.
You have been listening from afar.
Yeah, yeah. It's sometimes torture. I'm not going to lie.
Oh. Oh, that's good to know. Our job here is done.
The Diet Coke and Mentos thing.
Oh.
I sat there like, guys, it's Diet Coke. Diet Coke. Diet Coke.
It's any Coke.
Every time you said Coke. No, it's specifically Diet Coke.
Okay, but at least we knew about it. And then there was Matt who just didn't know anything. So
well, that's true.
That's what that puts you slightly
ahead. Still doesn't believe the whole thing.
We need to test. We're going to test clearly, it before the next podcast.
Sometimes if somebody recorded me like listening to the podcast, you would hear me just like shout random things at random times. Super
Jeez.
Cool.
Let us launch right into our musings. And let me ask, how was your Christmas, everyone? Oh, good. That was nice to hear. Well, we have to start off with the very special gift that Lauren received about a week before Christmas.
It was amazing.
Which was documented on video. Matt had the quickness of mind to pull out his phone and record the experience of you opening your gift from Coaster
Crew.
And
then I can't believe you posted the entire thing. I was really hoping for just like a snippet of the video.
Oh,
but
you wanted
no.
it edited. No.
The whole thing. No.
So the long-awaited coffee table book that I've been talking about every podcast, it came. It exists.
I knew it was going to come.
And it's not just a little
so much
scrapbooky
more.
Thing.
Yeah, I know. It's so much more than I ever could have hoped for or imagined. There's a story. And there's like more pictures than what they've posted.
Wow.
Like, it's incredible.
Maybe they did like a giant like photo shoot one day with them and they've just been like slowly releasing the photos.
Oh, that would be smart.
That would be interesting to find out.
No, yeah. Because some of them seemed more timely. Like some of them seemed online.
Some
after
of them,
our
direct responses to the podcast. So,
this is true. Know. So where will this book be on display?
It'll be in my office. My office is back to being an office.
Yes, the main offices, of which I am not a tenant, nor is Eric, are getting a redo with paint.
We're in the peasants' quarters.
Yes.
Okay, for the record, the last time the main office was painted or recarpeted, I think, was at least 25 years ago.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah.
It's been a while.
Your office rents did not exist then.
And ours look pretty fresh, so.
Yeah. So right now, my office is waiting for carpet.
But you've been painted.
Yes.
But you haven't been carpeted yet.
No.
So are you going to have a special shelf? Should we declare a Ho-Oh-Po museum?
I think I'm going to get like one of those like book stands. That way I can like stand it up on
like
display.
Yeah. That's cool.
Very cool. I'm really pumped about it.
You can put
your
little dog squeaker on there when you're not using it for the podcast.
Very cool.
Be a great collection.
Thank you so much to Coaster Crew.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Any other Christmas stories from any of the...
Ugh. I took the long pilgrimage to New York via car.
Ooh, you drove this
time. I drove. Well,
what kind of route do you take? Which direction do you go?
On the way there, we were celebrating in New York City. So on the way there, I went through West Virginia and then up to Maryland, up to Pennsylvania. So that was a new route. It was kind of cool. On the way home, I went and visited my brother. He lives in Manhattan. And that was a mistake. So I went and visited. Well, once you live here for a while, you forget how to drive in like a city.
That's fair.
I mean, really.
Yes.
So I go down to see him. I have trouble getting to his place. He lives on like the east side. And I stay for a few hours. And I'm like, I want to hit the road and make it, you know, into Pennsylvania. I left during rush hour.
Ooh.
And I took the Holland Tunnel, waited a half hour outside of it.
Even
to get
we
into
city
it.
Folk or country folk know about that
Holland
idea.
Tunnel. Oh, but yeah, it was just, and my heart was racing, and I knew I had Indiana license plates, which wasn't going to buy me anything.
No one's intimidated by an Indiana license plate.
Well, if anything, it was going to make it worse. Like, people were going to cut me off. Yeah. And so it was very, I was very overwhelmed. So I was very, I was going to be happier to like see nothingness in the distance. So that was my story.
I know that feeling well. Okay. Any other special gifts? I have to tell you about one. A few weeks before Christmas, Gary, my husband, and I went and visited my parents who live in Madison, Connecticut. They're both 86 years old. And they're at the point, God bless them, where they're like, my mom's like, here, I want you to have my jewelry. And it's like, I don't want your jewelry. But mom, you know, wanted to, so she bequeathed me some beautiful jewelry. And this is so special to me, her original typewriter. My mom is a poet. Aww. She's had her poems published in Yankee magazine and other publications. Wow. And she has this glorious old Royal typewriter that she wrote her poetry on in college and such. And we're redoing, it's an interesting, situation as your children grow and move out. And it's like, what do we do with this bedroom? So one of the bedrooms has been changed into we're going to call it the study, because everything else sounded really pretentious, like the writing room. Ready. So we're going to call it the study. But we specifically bought some furniture that has a nice display case in it. And the Royal typewriter is there. So I absolutely love it.
That's
so
cool.
Thanks, Mom. Yeah,
that's
so I'm
really
going
nice.
To try
that's
to start cool. a family blog because I'm not blogging enough as it is.
On the typewriter?
Not on the typewriter. we'll write about the typewriter on the blog. Once
how do you blog on
you
a
just
typewriter?
Stick like a USB cable in the typewriter yeah. anywhere.
And a modern typewriter.
Yeah, I keep working to where things plug in.
Oh my gosh.
Well, we did receive some very nice Christmas cards for the Pod Squad, which I thought was really aww. Nice. And I wanted really? To show them to you. And here's one from our buddy, Christopher Knight.
Oh, yeah. Aww.
And unfortunately, Matt's not here to make his Brady Bunch reference, but we all know.
That's okay.
Yeah.
And he says, Christopher says, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, Paula, Matt, Eric, Lauren, and Leah.
Yes.
Three exclamation points. Your friend, Christopher Knight. Thank you guys for a wonderful 70th birthday season. Can't wait to see what the 71st season has in store for you. Thank you for the great memories at the park and on the podcast. I hope you all have a wonderful holiday season. Hashtag ho-ho-po.
So- How nice. So you need to include it.
I just got like misty-eyed from that.
Yes. Aww.
I don't know why.
And then one from Brian Bird. A nice Snoopy card. Snoopy with a Santa hat.
Oh, cute. I like the Woodstocks in the back.
Bright moments, warm memories. Have yourself a merry little Christmas and Halloween and 4th of July and Thanksgiving. I admit I'm a copycat because I never thought of sending a Christmas card to an amusement park until I heard about it on the podcast. But I figured my minor celebrity status as a ho-oh famous pumpkin logo carver gave me reason enough to send you all warm winter greetings. Anyway, just wanted to wish everyone a joyous holiday season. I look forward to seeing you again at Hollywood Nights. Brian Bird.
Aww.
Very nice.
So that, and then another in this package I didn't get till after the holidays, but from our friends at Coaster 101.
Oh, cool. Look at that card.
And they have their own card. Thanks for allowing us to include Legend in our 2017 calendar and for your continued ooh-hoo. Support of Coaster 101. If there's ever anything you need from us, please don't hesitate to reach out. And then he also included a calendar for each member of the Pod Squad.
Oh, I love calendars.
So here's one. And if you look to so April, what will you see?
So excited.
Oh, I flipped to
April. Where did you go the wrong month?
Yeah.
That's right, everybody.
Leah, Sister Coaster is there.
How did you get there?
Can you find
like
it?
Hang this up in my
there
apartment.
It is. Whoa.
And like
and
keep
it's
track
new. It's the new
up till April and then just leave it on April all year
just
round.
Just leave it on April or you tear the other months off.
Yeah.
Just have it be. It's April
the rest
all
of year.
That is an awesome picture too.
So thank you, mm-hmm. Coaster 101.
I flipped to my birthday month.
What's your birthday month? July. Cool. All right. Well, as we move past Christmas, we head into New Year's. And of course, New Year's resolutions are a big thing this time of year. And I had a question. Does anyone have a New Year's resolution, because I think, isn't it putting it in writing or saying it out loud, you tend to keep your resolution?
I think it's the opposite.
That's a theory. Make it worse.
I always announce that I'm going to lose 20 pounds. And I don't actually do that, though. My resolution is typically read a book a month for the year.
And how's I find that going so far?
As long as I count audiobooks, I'm good.
Ah,
that should count. I mean,
still, yeah.
Reading,
so maybe having consume a book.
Yeah,
a
consuming
book.
A book. Yeah, there we go. I was like, I can't come up with a verb for this. But yeah.
That sounds nice. Like a really, are you reading a book right now? Other than textbooks, MBA candidate.
No, I'm kind of failing right now. Okay. I've been listening to a lot of educational podcasts though, so I'm like kind of one. Counting that.
Do any of them make me as angry as
like us in TED Talks?
No, the rest of them just make me driving in my car aloud. I sound insane when I listen to podcasts, for the record. Just
because they're you're interacting.
Yes. You're interactive, yes, aren't you?
Yes, I am. So,
do you gotta have a dummy sitting in the passenger seat so it looks like you're talking to somebody?
Oh no, I don't. I lost that a long time ago. Being nervous about people me talking to myself in my car. I don't care. But no, those podcasts, you'll find me like sitting there going, oh, "What? I never knew that. Oh my gosh, that's so cool."
Podcasts are underrated.
Not kidding you.
Yeah. I mean, you're great stuff.
Great stuff.
It seems like last year was the year they really kind of came alive. We were really, we were on the cutting edge.
The year of the podcast.
We jumped right in. Anyone else reading any good books right now? Do you read more now that you could get an ebook versus buying a hard copy?
I still wait for the hard copy. Like, given the choice on Amazon, I never get the ebook.
I think I've told you about that before. That's daily email I get from BookBub, and all the books, their ebooks, they're $1.99 or less.
Oh wow!
And there was one that came out in September called The Santa Claus Man. And it's like, who can't? And I have not finished reading it yet, but I was all excited. And Gary calls me every day at lunchtime, and he says, "Did you get your BookBub yet?" Because he's always very, because Gary, no one reads more than that man. Our house is just full of books. We have literally taken out a bathtub to put in more bookshelves. So, luckily, we have a bathtub elsewhere in the house.
I was going to say,
yes, we have many, many, many books.
That's where I'm headed.
And I was reading the Santa Claus Man, and this is the gentleman who actually started responding to letters from Santa once the U.S. Postal Department back in 1913 allowed it to happen, because it was prohibited before them. They would not release the mail. They would just go to the dead letter office, anything written to Santa Claus, and they just get destroyed. So this gentleman hopped on board in New York City when it was allowed, which that helps explain how we look back here in Santa Claus, Indiana. Mm-hmm. Our responses to letters to Santa started right at the same time at 1914. Mm-hmm. So now we know why it was that year. Why was it that year?
Wow. Interesting.
So I haven't finished the book yet, but it's very interesting. Apparently it doesn't end really well as far as this particular gentleman. So I'll be sure to report back to you all what happens. But on Christmas, when we were exchanging gifts, it turns out my true BookBub, my husband, had already ordered me the hard copy of The Santa Claus Man. So he wasn't real pleased with old BookBub. But then Gary had his own, because Gary won't even touch my iPad since he wants to be Amish and he doesn't have anything to do with anything electronic. So he read so he's already done reading. I haven't finished.
So he doesn't do the audiobooks.
He's done. Oh no. The closest thing to audiobook is me reading an article aloud to him.
I almost bought you a book, Paula, over the Christmas holiday, but then I was like, oh, she probably already has it. I'll tell you after.
Tell me after. It's all right.
No, I'll tell you after.
Why do I have a feeling it has to do with The Real Housewives? It does, doesn't it?
You're on the right track.
I have Bethany's book already, one of them. Oh. Well, since our dear friend, President Matt Eckert, is not here, I thought this would be the perfect time to talk about news resolutions that we would like him to make.
Wow.
So I did ask the Pod Squad to bring an idea to the table.
I think Eric needs to go first. Because you were the one who responded to the text first.
Okay. Yeah. Well, over the weekend,
what is the story with this one?
Yes. I'm going to the store to get some, I'm back from New York and I want to get some stuff and my phone goes off. Clicking, you have a new Twitter message, or not message, like a notification. I'm like, that's weird. Who's doing it? Matt Ecker. He posts this Twitter photo of him and his son at a game. So he's becoming an active tweeter. So my resolution to him was going to be to, well, at first it was going to be don't tweet a lot, you know, be careful.
Careful with the tagging people thing.
Yeah. Well, he didn't tag. Yeah. And he didn't tag. Okay, it just it got just the notification. Cause I
was like, did he tag you?
I don't have a lot of Twitter friends. Really, you know, I'm not very good at the tweet. Well, it's not like that.
Oh, yes, it is. I notice you do respond whenever you are tagged.
Because I know it doesn't happen a lot. I'm not a very good, I'm not good at the tweeting. And the joke, that's always been the joke for Matt, because he only got on there once it was Save Rayvon, right?
Right. Hashtag Save Rayvon.
Yeah. That's right. So he's joked about how like he doesn't really know how to use it.
Single-handedly saved Rayvon.
So he didn't just reply. He actually had, he made a Twitter post. So instead of saying, don't tweet as much, it would be tweet more often.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, that's a nice one. Does anyone have something a little more critical?
Yeah, I do.
All right.
Well, I had another one, but this one came up before the podcast and it drives me nuts more than the other one. So I'm going to go with this one. So every time we record a podcast, we have to do a noise print. So we have to stay silent for about 5 seconds, which is for us is pretty much pure torture. And normally ends in us laughing. I don't know how, but yeah.
So once you make eye contact.
So and by noise print, it's actually absence of noise.
Yes, it's absence. Yeah, we have to get like the sound of the room. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So Paula will count us down like normally every time, like, you know, she'll say three aloud, then she'll count down two and one on her hands and we stay silent. Okay. So in theory, after she does the one, there should be no more noise, right? That's how it should work.
You've had your time to clear your throat, to swallow, gurgle, sniffing.
Matt, every time without fail, Paula does the one and it like right after she does the one, actually it's almost even like a second after the one, Matt will go.
You made it extra huge, wheezy. Yeah.
Take a huge breath in and hold it. And we always just sit there and go, like, look at him like, are you serious right now?
I'm just glad you brought this up because when you said it earlier, I thought I was the only one who like would notice that and shoot daggers from my
head. But he holds his breath.
Well, we all do, but like he audibly inhales after the one. If you're going to inhale,
he's such a victim about it.
3 seconds. To so
my New Year's resolution for Matt is to not do that anymore. Yeah. Breathe before the one.
Did you bring a whole list of things or was this the only one?
Well, there was that. And then my other one was just,
I figured there was more than one.
to not be such a sore winner/loser. Because it works both ways.
He is pretty bad. We all rag on each other, but he's like
that one time when we had a tie and he was the loser.
He like
wouldn't even play for the whole next.
Yeah, he goes, "What's the point?" Yeah.
I'm just saying. I'm pretty sure he won more episodes of 70 Degrees than me, but he kept that in his heart that I won a lot at the very beginning. Mm-hmm. And he just like was like, "Well, Leah would win anyway."
Like, I haven't been there in 2 months.
Kicked my butt most of the season on this game, but you remember like the 4 times I beat you? Are you kidding me?
He does not forget.
He does not forget. No. Well, my resolution for Matt would be, I don't know if you guys have noticed this, but Matt likes to talk in monologues.
No, tell me.
He starts to answer a question, but he has to tell a story with the question to give you the full answer to it.
I guess I've never picked up on that.
And I noticed it one day. And once I noticed it, I was like, tighten up, Matt, tighten up. Let's keep those monologues a little shorter. Tell the story. They're mostly endearing, but tighten up.
Oh, I'm going to watch for that now.
We still love you, Matt. Don't worry.
Yeah, I'm poor guy. He's not here to defend himself.
I'm making a mental note never to miss a podcast ever again.
Yeah. Oh, Leah.
And we will know once he's listened to this because you guys will get the cold shoulder.
We're going to get a serious cold shoulder.
You will never get your new carpet anymore. You'll just be sitting for months at a time saying, when can I move back into my office? Not today.
He'll go.
Want to know the whole story? Oh, that's right. He doesn't want me. Maybe I'll tweet it to you later. Well, mine, this is something that will come absolutely no. Well, I just used the word that I was going to talk about. This will come as absolutely, Matt, no surprise, is Matt's use of the word absolutely when he is being interviewed and someone asks a question that's just a simple yes would do. He always says, and he does it to bug me. That's the thing, is we've talked about it and I've explained how the use of the word,
he knows now.
And he cannot resist knowing he gets under my skin, it's irresistible. It's like, not when you're doing an actual interview. You can tease me all you want off the air, but on the air, you need to stop. Oh, absolutely.
Oh.
But it all started for me, the 24-hour news cycle, you know, where reporters run out of people to interview, so they interview each other. They all do that all the time. They'll go, you know, and you're at the scene. Is that correct? Absolutely. It's like, there's no absolute there. It's just yes and yes, move I'm on. So Matt, he will always, if he uses the word absolutely, he'll look over at me and I could just see, it's like, see, I did it again.
He is going to come back so self-conscious.
I am sure that, no, he won't. He's just like, oh, I
he's going to come back just done with all of us. Yeah. He's just going to monologue straight the entire episode over everybody.
He'll pull the plugs on our mics and he'll just talk and
he'll
use
come back
the
with
word
list of absolutely. For us.
Yeah, we're all in trouble. We may need to edit this whole part out of the
Let's walk away
about this.
This was a mistake. Never mind.
Well, let's officially welcome back Leah, although we've already said hello. And I did ask if you had anything that you'd like to share about what you have learned. Now you're working on your MBA up at Indiana University.
Ooh, what have I learned?
What have you learned?
I learned?
Oh, boy.
She's really...
I know everything. No.
You look smarter. I have to tell you that.
Stop.
You're glowing with smartness.
I've learned that I am not good at finance in the sense of capital markets. Which is not.
What does that mean? That tells you.
Our entire finance thing was about like the capital markets and getting capital projects like funded.
Oh, okay.
I am not good at it, so I can't really explain it to you. My test score would let you know that.
What's your best?
What's my best?
Yeah, your subject? Best subject.
Probably strategy.
Oh.
I did fairly well in accounting and strategy.
I love it.
Strategy was really fun. We got to do a thing on GoPro. That was like a big project, and we like had to analyze the situation they're in right now because I didn't realize it, but they're not doing so great.
Wait, really?
Wow.
Yeah. And so my recommendation was based on the fact that the Travel Channel comes here a lot and they always come with GoPros, like every news outlet. And so my recommendation was to start focusing on business to business and start selling to like designing their product for the businesses, for the production companies, things like that.
That's shocking to me because you see show that you watch where they're doing like little snippets of stuff, they're always using a GoPro.
Yeah. So many people have come out with the same product.
Oh yeah.
And for cheaper, but they're in price competition. They can't really do a lot about it. So,
you know what? It's all about innovation.
My recommendation is business to business.
Wow.
Cool. I did pretty well on the project. So,
and then you head back to school next week.
Yep. But I have Fridays off. So,
oh,
well,
wait a minute.
So I might be able to podcast every now and then.
Very cool. That would be fun. You know, cool. I miss you. When you're gone.
I missed you guys too.
All left us.
Even when I'm yelling at you guys, I miss
Leah.
You.
I miss Leah.
I appreciate Paula's like
my whining
obligatory every episode.
Well, you were here yesterday. We had a lot of fun where we shot a little video intro yesterday. We're going to kind of reuse our mannequin video from last month by adding pop-ups to it to explain all the little hints we had.
Oh,
and we
cool.
wanted to have an intro to go ahead and lead into it. And so we gathered Leah and her siblings plus Matt in the paint shop yesterday morning to do the intro and the outro.
The 1,000-degree paint shop.
It was not that warm.
It was when you had a jacket on.
So dramatic.
I had a jacket on. It wasn't that
You're
warm.
Always cold. You don't count.
Your opinion
on temperatures never counts.
Did anybody else keep thinking the lights were windows? Okay, there's something wrong with me because it was a
gloomy
day. You
were looking at it a different way though, so.
But I kept going, oh no, those aren't windows. And then a few minutes later, it's like, wow, it's sunny out because it was very gloomy yesterday. Yeah. I bet 5 times. And I just thought, what is wrong with me that I can't lock it in my brain that those are lights? But they were vertical in nature. And they just look like these little, but they were so bright, but they're all over the booth. it's we have a paint shop, and within the paint shop there's a big room called the booth. Those were not, oh, you weren't in there yet. Oh,
no,
you,
but I've been in
you
there.
Weren't part of that yesterday. Sorry, Eric.
It was in the like
I can take you in there if you want a tour. But the booth the where actual, they can shut everything down and do all the like vented, painting.
The vented where you can actually it's like safe for paint.
Yeah.
Safe for paint. And but we lined you up, and I thought the most interesting thing is it seemed like the first take was the best take on just about everything.
Yeah.
You guys are pros at this point.
And including when you all had to speak at once.
Except for the very, very first one.
I thought the very first one was, now what was happening? I must have missed what.
Lauren wasn't in it.
I just didn't think that we were going to start. right like that
second.
Yeah, so I'm like thinking like, oh, we're just gonna pause and then we're gonna start, and everyone just started and I just couldn't even hop in. I was just like
yep. I mean, the line was Happy New Year, Ace, so there's not a lot of opportunities to jump in.
Once you miss the hap, it's over.
Yeah, we were sending versions to some of the coaster clubs have off-season events, so we went ahead and personalized them for several of the different clubs. But yeah, and then everybody had to say greetings from Santa Claus, Indiana. That was a challenge.
That was.
Getting everybody to, and I think part of it was Stephen was doing the countdown with his fingers, and when he pointed you, were you meant to start talking immediately or take a beat?
There was definitely confusion on that one.
It's like the age-old question, to take a beat. On three or after three?
I took a beat. I think William wanted to go on the point.
Yeah, because there was somebody who was definitely starting exactly when the point happened, and others were taking a beat. So it
makes
was
me think of
very interesting
entertainment when Corey Seib used to go 2-on-3 and everyone would put their hands in and they'd go 1-2-2.
Oh, I get
so
it.
So instead of three,
I don't.
You did two.
2-on-3.
You say two, the most on confusing. Three.
1-2-2.
Get it on three.
So you say two on three.
What was the purpose of that?
Confusing everybody. Have the lamest like it pump worked. Up moment.
It did work.
Thank you, Corey.
Because generally it was like 1-2.
What?
Two.
Yeah.
And then at the end, we wanted just everyone to say see you soon. And then started. And somehow that was really
hard.
Like,
the see you real
someone
soon.
Had to then, say see you real soon. And then I was done.
Just like the Mickey Mouse Club. And then we couldn't do it. So we had to. Yeah. Add the real soon. And so that's our little nod to Annette Funicello, may she rest in peace, and all the rest of the gang from the Mickey Mouse Club, which I actually watched when it first came out. So it was quite a while ago. And I actually knew someone named Annette. So I remember I was not even in kindergarten yet, but I remember feeling very special that I knew someone, the girl across the street in Milford, Connecticut. Wow. Her name was Annette. So I thought that was pretty cool. But we will get that that video posted probably by the end of the week on YouTube. And we hope everyone goes and watches it. And by the way, if you want to subscribe to YouTube and all of our other social media, you can go to holidayworld.com/connect. And we've put everything there together so you can just subscribe to everything so that you're constantly bombarded with news and information.
We have a lot of offer.
And fun stuff from Holiday World.
Stop talking.
Yeah. Some other work that's going on that I'm sure was more comfortable the last couple of days. Today it's gotten very cold, but work on The Voyage. And Eric, you did a little research to find out what was going on up there.
Well, not a lot has changed since we last spoke, but
we've been on break.
Because we've been on break, yeah. So have our coaster guys. But so not much has changed, but they are pulling track ties out and putting new ones in. And I wanted to mention that if you drive by the backside of the park and you can see The Voyage, you notice a structure that's over the track. And I think people are wondering, why is the track covered? And what it is they've built kind of like a makeshift tunnel to keep them protected from the elements while they do the track work. So it's really cool.
It's kind of that covered wagon look.
Yeah.
That we did with Legend last year.
Yeah. So they did that. They do, and that'll come down, but they do that just so that they, you know, when it is super cold or
windy.
If they get any rain, so they can get their work done. So yeah. I thought that would be, in case anyone drove by and wondered what is going on? Yeah.
What are they doing now?
And then that's pretty much it. And then Raven and Legend, structure work is done at the Raven was almost done at Raven and completely done at Legend.
Great. There's so we'll have smoother than smooth wooden coasters.
Yeah.
I was going to say next year, but no, it'll be this year.
Oh.
We open the end of April.
It's 2017.
It's not that far away.
I haven't had to date anything yet, but
neither have
it's
I.
It's going to be a mess.
It's going to be a mess.
Going to get really good at turning sixes into sevens.
Yes. See, I'm actually like really like already prepared for this because with being in special events, as soon as the season ends,
I'm already planning
the next year. So in December, I'm in 17. I think I had to write a check or something in December and I put 17.
That is
how much I am in 17 already. So I'm ready.
I always have that confusion in November and December because we're working on 17 things, but we still have 16 things going.
Yeah.
Always in fear that I'm going to post something wrong on social media. Of course, I'm sure, you know, 25 people will point it out to us immediately if you've got it wrong. But so far, so good. Been meaning to get Holiday World season passes. Terry, no longer. That was for you, Leah. Terry, no longer. The best prices for season passes expire on January 15th. So that's just, what, a week and a half away.
Oh, no.
Go to holidayworld.com/passes for all the details on our easy pay monthly payment program, season pass perks, and more. So once again, the best prices are going away after January 15th for our season passes. And everybody wants season passes, don't they?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. You get to visit whenever you want, and you can stay as long as you want, or just come in for something to eat, watch a show, ride a couple of rides, and go home. You don't necessarily have to stay all day. So it's season passes are great fun. And we recommend them. We all have them, don't we? Yes, we do. We are Holiday World and we love holidays. Let's take a look at some of the holidays that are coming up. Today is National Trivia Day. Did you know that?
Ooh.
That was something not everyone knows, that it's Trivia Day.
Might have gotten a heads up.
And I did ask the pod squad to each come up with some ho-o trivia that they'd like to share. Who'd like to go first?
No, not me.
Eric's got it written down on a piece of paper. So
I don't want to go first.
I'll go first because I don't feel like mine's that great. It's more sentimental.
Oh. You always sell it so well.
I know.
Well.
I really, I really built it up. This is like all I could come up with because like we were saying before the podcast started, we've already talked about so many like weird, trivial things about the park that it's like, we've covered so many good things for this. But so I came up with, right before the break, it was Christmas break. It was decided that I would be moving offices and no longer sharing an office with my sister.
Aren't you sad?
I'm growing up.
Mostly because she wasn't sharing an office with me anyway.
But it was decided that I would be moving into what was my dad's old office. So that's my fun little bit of trivia is that I now get to be in my dad's old office.
Which one was his?
It used to be Allison's.
Oh, very cool. I like the trivia. I didn't
see the secret back door.
Back whenever cash control was
super cool.
Was up in the main office. That was my dad's office. And fun fact, my first year that I worked in cash control, it was up in the main office. So I would work there and I was a little shy kid, little 14-year-old, you know, me. And I would go and get some lunch from Kringles, but I didn't really want to go to the Christmas break room because I didn't know anybody and I didn't want to sit out in Kringles. So I would go, and I would sit in my dad's office and watch him work while I ate my food.
That's cool. That was good. See, you shouldn't preface it like that. That was good.
And before it was your dad's office, it was our first aid.
Was it really?
No, it wasn't.
It was.
I don't remember
first aid in there.
Oh,
remember?
My.
And it was also actually our conference room. I remember having, this was 25 years ago, because I remember having meetings in there where there were maybe six directors.
Oh.
No, there was just this one little table in there. We all crowded
around
it. It
is weird because it has that back door in it. It's got like two exits.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which I know could very much come in handy.
Mm-hmm.
Here's somebody coming. Get your escape hatch. All right, Leah, what do you have?
Okay, so this one I asked my mom for help with last night, and she reminded me of a story that is odd, but I'm going with it. So fun fact.
With trivia.
It's, like
it's trivia!
Again, trying not to like repeat things we've already covered, mom reminded me that back when the Raven was first built, dad won... Sunday morning while we were in church was out adjusting the camera on the Raven.
Oh,
I remember this story. And a lightning strike came.
Yep.
And did knock him. He was on the track.
It hit the track.
And
then went
Yeah.
Through him.
Yeah.
Because he was on the track.
Knocked him off the track by lightning.
Knocked him off the track. And he doesn't know. He didn't remember how long he was out. Yeah. But he just remembers waking up on the ground.
Yep. It was the Sunday of Memorial Day weekend.
And he fell about 9-10 feet, right?
And somehow was okay.
Yeah. Yeah, he was adjusting with a... And it was one of those, we had no warning a storm was coming. I mean, you look up at the sky, it was not a stormy day. And I remember it went boom. And your dad was actually on the radio at that point. So he was in the middle of conversing with somebody. Yeah. We heard that boom. I was out at the front gate. And I remember Steve Hauser used to be the admissions director. He went flat on the ground. I don't know what he thought. I don't know if he had been in the military or something.
It was so close.
But it was so loud. He hit the floor or the pavement and everybody was just startled. Mm-hmm. And then everybody was like, is everybody okay? Well, we should have asked on the radio if everybody was okay. Is your dad? And I remember thinking, I hope Will's okay. And then I went merrily about my business. Found out later on, you know, he had smoke coming out of his ears.
Oh, my God.
Just for clarification, we're a lot more safe now.
Yes.
That was my dad, though. He would just do whatever it takes to get the job done.
Actually, the piece of trivia about this is dad rarely missed a Sunday of church after that.
That's funny.
Yes, he paid attention.
What year was that? When was this?
Oh. Wow.
Well, it would have been 95 was when Raven was at it. Yeah. I bet it was 96.
So right after that.
It was pretty soon after that. But it hit a tree that was right near the track and zapped through the track. And
did he have like those marks? You know, when people get struck by lightning, they have like those marks on them.
I don't think so.
I think he did. I think he was a little out of it.
Yeah. Like, I don't think it like
day, but
thoroughly got him. Like it just went into him enough to
knock him out.
Yeah.
I'm just picturing, you know what I'm picturing? That kid climbing that wall on Jurassic Park. When the electricity comes on and he just flies back.
I don't know that it was quite that dramatic.
But I think he did need to get a new two-way or new radio after that. I think that may be fall victim too.
But that's some very specific trivia for you.
There. Yeah, it is.
Thank you. Very good. Eric,
I don't
what you
go
got?
Now. I don't have a cool story like that.
Well, you've only been here 2 years, so you're building your trivia.
So I have no fun stories. Mine was just, I pulled the stats for the most riders, like which day we had the most. I didn't know if this was trivia we were just going to share or we were going to ask the listeners to figure out which day it was.
Okay, just go.
Okay. So the day that we had the highest amount of riders was this past season was July 16th.
July 16th.
Most riders on all of our rides.
See, that's interesting. Hmm,
yeah. In Holiday World, it was July 16th. Swash and Safari was July 9th. More riders than Swash and Safari on July 9th. But combined, it was still July 16th.
See, look, you're drawing like normal podcast responses out of me right now.
Interesting.
Fascinating.
Good. Trivia. And then they got struck by lightning.
No, they didn't.
No, sorry.
Stop.
It didn't work.
It's definitely not.
All right. My little bit of trivia actually has to do with the birth date of William Albert Cook I and William Albert Cook III. They had the same birthday. Which is January 10th, which is coming up, next week?
Yeah.
So happy birthday, William. And remembering Bill Cook, who was not our founder. He was the son of our founder, but he was, Bill Cook was here many, many years and was really our early developer. He really, he was a great guy. And now William's here too. It's neat, but it was, it was very neat that they were born on the same day.
Yeah, that's cool.
Was a wonderful tribute to Bill Cook. So happy birthday, William. All right. Moving away from trivia to January 5th, which is tomorrow, was National Bird Day.
Okay.
So George the Eagle.
Thunderbird and Raven.
George.
Yeah. Well,
have you been watching the live coverage of the baby eagles? I've heard about it, but I have not.
Not.
Have they hatched?
The first one has.
On New Year's Day.
Has the second one hatched?
I don't know.
They thought there was a crack, and then they thought it was maybe just a piece of grass on it. It's been kind of interesting to watch, but it's, you know, it's like watching paint dry, you know, watching
the miracle of life.
And, you know, I wonder, does the eagle know that that's going on? Is there a light there that's bothering them?
Like an incubator type thing?
I don't know. Well, I mean, it's an actual nest. I don't know where exactly the nest is, but anyway, it's neat to know that there are more eels being born because they are pretty darn rare. Mm-hmm. But we do have a lot of birds represented in our ride names.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thunderbird and
Crow's Raven. Nest. It's not really like a bird. Well,
Eagle's Flight.
Eagle's Flight. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So have a wonderful day, all the birds out there.
Yes.
And Brian Bird, our friend.
Yes.
His last name is B-I-R-D. So he gets a nod as well. January 11th. This is like the best holiday ever. National Step in the Puddle and Splash Your Friends Day. What does that even mean?
You know, when you do that.
How big of a puddle has to be to actually splash your friends?
That'd be a pretty big puddle.
Yeah. So I don't know. Has anyone
ever seen that video? It's like on YouTube where they're like, there's two people walking side by side and they're splashing the puddle. And then one person just does a big leap into a puddle, but the puddle's like 6 feet deep.
And you
can't, it's so funny. And you can't tell it because it's all like around the road. It's the funniest thing. I got to tell somebody the thing.
And really, I hadn't thought of this until just now, but the thinking of splashing in puddles and dancing in puddles and the wonderful Singing in the Rain movie. We do pass along our condolences to everyone who loved both Debbie Reynolds and her wonderful daughter, Carrie Fisher. That was hard. That was, I think hit everybody hard.
And yes.
We all admire both of those great ladies. And there are.
I was watching Star Wars last night.
I know. I watched 4, 5, and 6 over the break.
Did you? Mm-hmm.
So anyway, that was very sad. January 14th is National Dress Up Your Pet Day.
All right.
That's every day in mom's house.
I was going to say, how many outfits does Elfie have?
She's got lots of sweaters right now. Although that dog is so tiny, she probably needs them just to go outside.
She was dressed up for Christmas, right? I know she was dressed up for Halloween.
Yeah. I don't know if she had a specific Christmas outfit, but she's been in sweaters a lot lately.
How about your cat? Eric, she won't let me.
You see this? That's from last night.
Oh, what happened?
She just, tutu. No, she's very temperamental. Pet her, she's purring, and then all of a sudden she just clenches.
That's enough.
Yeah. That's why I don't have cats.
Yeah. I gotta get rid of her. Sorry.
What does that even mean?
You know, we have that kind of relationship.
She's back at the house planning
something.
We've
had a good run. A good run.
I remember when you thought she was lost. Yeah. You were beside yourself.
I was really scared.
No talking like that.
Yeah.
How about your dog, Lauren?
He has some outfits. He doesn't really care to wear them. Yes, Edgar. He has outfits, but he doesn't really like them. He spends
his time trying to get out of
them. He has a Florida State jersey that for whatever reason he does like to wear, which my husband obviously takes pride in that. Right. But yeah, most of the time if we put other outfits on him, I will walk out of the room, come back in, and he's halfway out of it. Actually, I have a wonderful picture of him halfway out of an outfit that I can send to you.
Send that to me.
It's really, it's really entertaining. That's
funny. It is time for a Ho-wo-po feedback. First, we heard from Steve Mosley at DSL Mosley on Twitter. Holiday World, please don't ever joke again about No More Ho-wo-po. It is an amazing podcast and makes me look forward to my first visit at Hollywood Nights. So Steve's coming to Hollywood Nights.
Yay!
Did we ever joke about Steve. Not doing the podcast?
There was a slight joke.
Oh.
The whole, like, we've done this for a year. We said we would do it for a year.
That's I was really listening,
were you?
Sorry. I was living
listen.
It.
He was sleeping. But don't worry, Steve. We're back again in the new year. We also heard from Kevin Van Osdol, V-A-N-O-S-D-O-L. And this was actually a post on the Hollow blog. And he said, quit the podcast. Are you kidding? This is the best. Well, thank you, Kevin.
Yeah, I didn't realize it was.
We have two fans that spoke out and demanded we continue. So here we are again. Speaking of which, I wanted to give a brief state of the podcast. You know, we have State of the Union, State of the State this time of year. For State of the Podcast, as we got probably into the midsummer, we really didn't have a specific goal as to how many listens we would be able to accrue over the year. But I think as we hit into the fall, the whole thought was, are we ever going to top 10,000 listens for one episode. And also it appeared like we might get up to 100,000 listens for the year last year. And we did that in early December. We topped 100,000 listens.
That's so cool.
And the most listened to episode, anybody have a guess as to which episode was the most listened to? It was the one with the Mankind.
Oh, of course.
Mick Foley, the wrestler.
We had a celebrity on.
Yes, which was great fun. Number 017, if you want to go back and
so
listen
cool.
or
he was so cool.
That was amazing. And so that one has, that's almost 11,000 listens so far for the Mick Foley. Next, we heard from Adam on Twitter, at CoasterCronAdam, and he said, Holiday World, the Voyage is also featured on the front cover of the CoasterNet 2017 calendar. So,
all right, we made another calendar.
So three calendars in one year. Cool. That's
pretty
that's
cool.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And that made me remember, maybe this fits in our little trivia category. Years ago, we were in a mainstream calendar that, I mean, you could go find it at Barnes & Noble and everything. And I was so excited about it. They didn't send us a free one, so I went to Barnes & Noble.
Did you go to Barnes & Noble just to buy it at Barnes & Noble?
Oh, yes, to buy it. And as I'm looking through it, I find it, and it was very exciting. And it said, it was probably a picture of, gosh, it was long enough ago. It was probably Raven or Legend. And it had a little caption. And then it said, in Santa Claus, Idaho.
No.
Yes. So whoever designed it thought ID was the abbreviation for Indiana. Idaho.
How that happened.
Oh,
like,
my
come
gosh.
On.
Yeah.
Sorry, it makes me so mad. Like, if I publish something, like...
Yeah, so I wrote to them. Like, it's going to help, because once they're out, they're out. Yeah. And I don't think you do a reprint of calendars.
Put stickers on every single
I know,
one.
It was. I demand issue stickers to mail to everyone.
Think about all those people who went all the way to Idaho for that.
I know. Looking for the Raven.
Looking for Raven.
Looking for Holiday World. Where's Santa Claus? Idaho. So, yeah, that was a lovely memory. Of course, we heard from the Coaster Crew, which is at Coaster Crew on Twitter. And this was from Santa Claus Land to Holiday World to Ho-Wo-Po. It all began with so Christmas. Adorable. Kitty likes to bring her own mistletoe.
The reindeer ears.
It's adorable.
And the Bigfoot, of course, is in the foreground wearing a Santa hat with the reindeer antlers and jingle bells. And looks like... there's a little mistletoe there over Kitty's head.
Oh.
There's a tree, a Christmas tree.
It's Sam's going to make a move.
They continue to bring it. Thank you, Coaster Crew. Zach Fuller also tweeted, at Zach ZB Fuller, Holiday World, hoping for a cool light package on Firecracker. I know we're going to have the big background sign with the Firecracker name that's going to be all.
Which looks so
they are
cool.
Working on it.
Yeah, we do have a Firecracker page on our website now. So yay for that. Woo-hoo. And that has an artist rendering. So you can see the logo and you can see where all the lighting will go on the backdrop, but then also the individual cars, which we're calling them cars, but I've also seen them called pods and gondolas. Somebody was calling them gondolas. Pods.
And then we could be the pod squad in a pod.
Let's look it all. That'd be a great photo op. Go out, sit in a pod. Zach, you can head over to the Firecracker page to get a look at what we have planned. Next, we heard from Kevin Williams, who wrote an email, which almost feels old fashioned at this point. It's just like, and this is a little long, but I think you'll enjoy it. Paula, my one and only daughter got engaged on Thanksgiving, and over Christmas, she and her soon to be husband set a wedding date of June 3rd, 2017. The same weekend as Hollywood Nights. I realize that asking you to change the date just for me would be very selfish. So I was wondering, is Holidog available to walk her down the aisle that Saturday? I would be happy to pick up his tux rental fee.
Wow. Oh,
I did show them the picture of the Voyage wedding from several years ago and suggested that as an option with a nice reception at Plymouth Rock and then get Kitty Claus to host a dance party. But for some reason, they did not like the idea. I think funnel cake is better than wedding cake anytime.
That's awesome.
enjoyed your classic park. I am sure that I will be staying in touch with several Costa Crazy friends via social media during the reception. And I will join you again in 2018 unless I am at the hospital awaiting the birth of a new grandchild. P.S. If she needs an oboe player to play the wedding march, do you have any suggestions?
I'm going to go with no. You don't want that.
Well, congratulations, Kevin, to your one and only daughter.
That is so cool.
That is wonderful. And we will miss you at Hollywood Nights, but we know you'll be where you need to be. Speaking of which, in the past when we had Hollywood Nights, probably a little earlier than that at the event that we had before that was called Stark Raven Mad, it seemed like one of the nights of the event was always Lauren and Leah's dance recital night.
Yes.
And so your dad would kind of go through what Kevin's going through, where he had to be where he had to be. Mm-hmm. And I know Will would always say he was always so glad to see both of you dance, but then having to sit through the rest of the recital was torture. And
he wanted those to were long helped. Recitals.
Yes, they were yes. long. Yeah.
Those were a great challenge. So when in the advent of texting, I know he took advantage of that to at least speak a couple of, how's it going up there? How's it going? Is everything okay? Mm-hmm. And that sort of thing. So that's another sweet memory from your youth. Next, we had quite a conversation on Twitter, actually just yesterday, with a married couple, David and Alyssa Y. We hear from the Ys quite a bit. In fact, let me see if I have the picture here. They were talking about, David said, if we want to guarantee the Y family gets season passes, he needs to know that we're going to have Bacon Land in 2017.
Please confirm.
So he's still on the wagon train.
That might be
train.
My favorite feedback.
I know.
Please confirm Bacon Land 2017.
And so they went from that conversation onto, do you remember this photo of their little boy, Kevin, their baby?
He's
one now.
Oh, yeah.
With the little feet.
Oh, that is the best photo.
Yes, I love that photo.
The test seat at Thunderbird. And so Alyssa asks, Kevin, can Kevin ride Thunderbird next season? And David said, we'll just sneak him on and close the restraint and hope the ride ops don't notice the two little feet sticking out.
Oh, no.
And then he tweeted again, Holiday World, that wasn't meant for you. It was. But thank you I love seeing that photo again of little Kevin's little bitty feet.
And so it's adorable.
And I know now we'll see Kevin probably at the park every year. And mm-hmm. when he becomes a teenager, we will bring this picture back out. Oh, yeah. Such cute little feet. Yeah. When he's got big 12. Size 12 feet or whatever as he gets older. But thank you. I hope, no plans for Bacon Land this year. Sorry, David.
We're confirming that.
But we'll talk 2018.
We'll see. Yeah.
Shouldn't say that.
We've got our strategist sitting right next to me. Yeah. Well, but she's also the one who has trouble with capital. So one may counteract the other.
The market.
Okay. Very good. Next, we heard from at IBWIP. COM, and he was looking at our jobs page. So I hope that doesn't mean you're out of a job, sir. But he said, can't do roller coaster maintenance because we have a full-time position open for roller coaster maintenance technician. He said, can't do roller coaster maintenance too high in the air. Do I get the VP job then? Because we're looking for a vice president of revenue operations. Well, perhaps you should look at the very next line. Qualified applicants should, the keyword being qualified, should please apply here. So, and that does bring up the point that we are now hiring for seasonal, many, many, several thousand seasonal jobs, as well as we do have some full-time positions open. So take a look at actually holidayworldjobs.com. We got that URL. We're getting that hooked up. So that'll take you straight to our jobs page. We heard again from the coaster crew and they said, let me pass this out so you can see it too. We're ready for a surprise announcement for a new Bacon Day Land. See there? The gravy days. Train as well. Strangely, Brush Your Teeth is not in George's book.
It's bacon toothpaste.
Kitty Claus is holding bacon toothpaste and has some on. We need to hear about I can't imagine. And George is reading a book called 101 Things to Do with Bacon.
See, that's a good use
hilarious.
Of Kitty's expression.
Yes, Kitty's like, oh. And then it looks like Holodog's actually holding a slice of bacon.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
So that's
good old bacon.
Thank you, Coaster Crew, once again. We also heard from Christopher Knight on Facebook. Remember, he had sent us a picture of Bacon Boy?
Yes.
Last time around, and we were all wondering where it came from, and we basically demanded more information from Christopher. And he, thank you for not letting us down. He said, here is some information about Bacon Boy. Bacon Boy is at Ministrista here, which is a museum in Muncie, Indiana. Muncie is the home of Ball Glass. Remember Ball Glass containers? Yeah. And so there, I'm not sure that the museum is all about glass, but apparently Bacon Boy is made out of glass. He's made out of glass. He stands about 12 inches tall. He's created from a drawing that a child had created. Isn't that neat? Hope this answered some of your questions. Let me know if you guys have any more questions. Thank you, Christopher. That helped. And I went online and looked at the museum, and they do have this wonderful exhibit of, I guess they took child's drawings and made them into glass figures. So indeed, Bacon Boy is at the Ministrista Museum in Muncie, Indiana, if anybody wants to go take a selfie with Bacon Boy and send it to us. We'll definitely talk about you the next episode. Next, we heard from Blake Clayton on Facebook, who on the 30th of December said, Happy Bacon Day. And I'm sure everyone... Bacon Day.
Talked about it on the last podcast.
I can't remember.
I think we have a new resolution
for Eric. I just have a lot going on up here.
That's what it is.
The collective crowd.
So Bacon Day was the 30th of December, and I'm sure everyone celebrated in their own special way. And we also heard from Zach Keeney on Twitter. And he is at Zach_Keeney. He said, listening to episode 22 and Eric Rentz's reaction to the bacon jam is the best.
Oh, yeah. I saw that on Twitter.
Which I do still have some in my mini fridge.
I can't remember the reaction. Oh, over the holidays, somebody had at Christmas dinner, bacon. It was a spread. And it made me think of the bacon jam. I didn't have any. It was a bacon jelly. It was bacon jelly.
Ah.
And at first I was, you know, we've been trained to like question everything. Everyone was like treating it normal. But all I could think about was the bacon jam, which actually was, you know, I really liked it.
Did you try the,
I did not try the bacon jam. I didn't even see it. I just heard someone like in the other room talking about how they had bacon jam.
So did you have multiple rooms of food at your celebration?
There was multiple rooms in this home we were in.
Okay.
And there were people spread out.
So
like,
there's like the jam room, the jelly room,
the dinner room, the appetizer.
Bacon. So much for not mentioning bacon.
I do want to go one episode.
And you'll be the one who says it.
No.
So I'm have to sit here with a buzzer and just wait.
Yeah.
For someone with a taser.
Yeah. We'll do it. I'll take that challenge.
And we heard from the Coaster Crew once again on December 31st. We've got the confetti party favors and cork to pop.
Cute.
We're just waiting on Holiday World to bring the firecracker. They're so clever. It's not just artistic in their design of their photograph. They're also witty with their word use.
Yes. I know.
And there's confetti sprinkled about, and the big green foot has
a glittery hat.
It's a very sparkly hat. They probably use, what is it that they're putting on the outer coat of the cars for firecracker? Big flake.
Ooh.
It's a big flake, the name of the product. We did a Facebook Live yesterday with Matt after we were done with our video. So you can go on Facebook and watch that. But Matt was very excited about the big flake.
I was just having a moment of that's where he was. I was looking for him.
Yes, we stayed behind and did one, which he did. He did a nice job. We had to meander our way through the paint shop and into the booth. And that's where we had the little chips to show the colors of the cars, as well as the samples of the big flake in both blue and red. And that's the final top coat, apparently, that goes on
the cars
as they paint them. So we'll be updating that.
I can't wait for it.
By video as we go along. Because right now they're all that kind of gray primer color, the cars
are.
It's
going to just look so good.
Four at a time. So they'll do what they were doing yesterday times four, because we have 16 cars. Pods or gondolas, whatever you want to to call them. Still need season passes for this year?
Fraudulous.
Our deepest discounts for season passes expire on January 15th, which is coming up soon. Go to holidayworld.com/passes for all the details on our easy pay monthly payment program, season pass perks, and more. It's that time again.
But is it?
Again, though.
Really?
No.
I thought this was a new game.
We are putting 70 degrees of separation, sadly, behind us. But I figured the question would come up, who won the most, seeing as we're a competitive bunch. And I started...
I don't want to know.
In a panic.
Who won the least?
Is this by just number of times or just actually a cumulative points?
And this gets to the... Basically, I started going back because I was keeping track of it all until... We had our mutiny and everyone wanted to do it individually. Yeah. Okay. And at that point, my notes don't contain who the winner was because I wouldn't know until the person who had helped, who had.
Okay.
So I'm going to declare a winner just based on the ones that I do have record of. Who do you think?
And
Leah wasn't here. So
I think Matt.
For half of them.
Probably Matt.
No, it was Lauren. Because you won the last three or four ones.
Look at you go.
So you are declared.
Look at me.
Now you don't want 70 degrees to leave.
And, no, I do. I still do.
And your mom won the one time she was here. Oh, so she won 100% of her time.
She is the best batting
time.
Average.
So So that's it. And that's what I was afraid that once, and, well, Matt's not here today, so maybe it wouldn't have come up, but it would be all that. Well, who was here based on how many times they were here and the percentage of how many they... So
here, hold on. I'll give you Matt's reaction.
Well, just...
Obviously, Lauren won. She's the favorite.
You would have won if she had been here.
Yeah, she's probably
the
second. Even though I would have won anyway.
But Matt was the only one who was declared a loser. So yay for you, Matt. So good for you, Matt.
I'm glad we're going to play this new game.
All right.
That's why he's not here. You know that, right?
Paula gave him the heads up. He's like, no.
He wants to see what the game is so he can get an advantage in the next game.
All right,
we are
ready?
So shunned.
Now you've all...
He's never coming back.
He's never coming back.
You've all heard the theory of 6 degrees of separation, right?
The last one started
And
like
you
this.
Know all about our wildly popular, yet tragically retired game, 70 degrees of separation. Well, it's time for a new game, right?
Oh, no.
Ready? It's been 33 years since we changed our name from Santa Claus Land to Holiday World. So let's play a game called 33 Degrees of Separation.
Oh, no.
Oh,
gosh, I'm not.
Yay. Oh, come on. Where are the cheers? Stephen, I hope you have a sound effect of cheering, of the crowd cheering you can add right here, because this is really sad up here.
This is at least a little more recent, guys. We might actually have a stab at this one.
See, that's what I was hoping.
Is that all it is?
If it makes you happy, when I went and looked 1984, who was born, I didn't recognize a single person. So it'll be more work for me, but you guys will, I'm sure, recognize people far more easily.
That means you're going to find the more obscure connections.
These are easy. These are really, really easy. I think they've gotten easier, haven't they? The 70 degrees?
Sometimes.
Okay. I think
I think nothing tops my potion master answer. I've been riding off of that ever since, since the first episode.
And I still love the Pollyanna. That was, I think, my favorite that Lauren came up with. So our contestants are given the name of someone or something that is connected with the year 1984 and must figure out the connection to us. First, though, we need to go back to the very last 70 degrees of separation and who won that.
Oh, right.
Lauren.
Obviously, she won. She's the favorite.
You're doing such a perfect Matt impression. It's like he's here.
Absolutely, she won. She's the favorite.
So if you have to talk now for 5 minutes.
Hold on, this is how it is. Absolutely, she won.
We're all fired.
I'm getting fired. This is my last day, guys. Please post this. Give me a week. Please post this next week.
We were saying we'll all know when he listens to it, because all of a sudden it'll be the cold shoulder, no return.
I hope he knows.
He's never
going to
leave again.
Matt, we miss you.
Yeah, he's either never going to come back or he's never going to leave again.
Yeah.
All right.
I expect the same in return.
We must start by testing our sound makers. Lauren, you go first. Squeaky toy, true squeaky toy, not electronic squeaky.
No.
All right. Eric. Electronic whistle.
Yes.
And Leah and her oboe. They are back.
Yay. Heard that in a while.
It's been quite a while.
I'm sure you've missed it.
All right. Are we ready? Are we ready? So. And your enthusiasm is...
I'm kind of excited.
Truly appreciated.
Really
well, thank you, Eric. Okay. The incredibly detailed rule book for 33 degrees of separation, oddly, does not specifically prohibit nepotism. And so let's start this new game with the name of an individual near and dear to my heart, born in 1984, Thomas Wernie. Thank you, Lauren.
Okay. So... Thomas Wernie, obviously Paula's oldest son. He worked in cash control for many, many years with Joe Hevron.
Yes.
And I also had the pleasure of working with both Tom and Joe whenever I first started working in cash control.
Very good. You nailed it. Leah.
I'm going to come in too and just say that Thomas was obviously very, 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 very smart. And even though I didn't get to work with him in cash control, I felt like I always kind of lived in his shadow because in Joe's mind, well, to be fair, everybody
yes.
in that department lived
fair.
In his shadow.
Yes.
Like nobody could compare.
Wow.
Like Joe was just like, hey, you know, anytime there was like a struggle with balancing or something, somehow Thomas would come up in the conversation.
Wow,
that's nice to hear. Yeah. You get an extra point for making me my eyes water a little bit there.
Of course, Leah gets extra points.
And Tom loved Joe. He loved Joe. And I do remember Leah or Lauren, sorry, for to your credit, that Thomas was very impressed with what a hard worker, even though I guess you had your lunch every day with your dad, that he was very impressed with how you just jumped in like anybody else and you worked hard. And I remember telling your dad that and he was very touched to hear that. How about you, Eric? Do you have anything?
I have never had the pleasure of meeting him, but I just learned a lot here. There's trivia. It's more trivia.
He is someone who can actually put on his Facebook page for his little bio that he is a rocket scientist. So, and he hates it when I brag, but yeah, he's an engineer at NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory. So,
we're not kidding you. Wow. We say he was super smart.
And Thomas was very intelligent. From a rocket scientist.
And he was already incredibly intelligent when he was here.
In high school.
Like, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. So he will, I'm certain, be mortified to know that he was included in a game on our podcast. All right. You have a chance to redeem yourself, Eric.
Okay.
All right. Here we go with our second. This book by Timothy Findley was published in 1984. The title of that book, Not Wanted on the Voyage. Eric.
Well, the Voyage is our third wooden coaster. And everyone's wanted on the Voyage as long as you meet all rider requirements. So if you don't, you're not wanted on the Voyage.
Okay.
Right?
Oboe.
On the Voyage, our roller coaster, there are many items that we would prefer you don't bring.
Oh, yes. So smart.
Yep. Wallets,
I'm sorry. Cell phones,
those loose articles.
I didn't think better.
Fly out and smack somebody. So remember that when you tried to take your phone on the Voyage,
that's right.
You could lose it. It could hurt somebody else. You could lose it. It will break if you lose it.
And I got to tell you
too.
What?
And it could hurt you too.
I could tell you this. Yeah. I could tell you they don't come back. They do not come back.
Like I never bring phones, whatever.
Right. Oh, I empty out all my pockets.
Yes. Don't even have it in your pocket. Nope. I know that's a discussion we've had with many people that, I wasn't actually using it. And it's like,
Trust me, that doesn't matter.
Don't bring it on the ride.
Yeah. You can have something in your back pocket, which you're sitting on and you still lose it.
And not to take a serious turn, but yes.
Yeah.
Too late. We've already taken this. We had one
well,
guy.
Well, because that's, you know what? This is bring up a great topic. Yeah. This is something that we talk a lot about.
Yeah.
Yes. It's, we had a guy on, I was on media day for the Voyage. So back 11 years ago, and he had a little camera. So this was before everybody camera was just part of their phone. He had it in his shirt pocket that zipped closed. The zipper broke while he was riding and it flew out and he lost his
it's an aggressive
camera.
Ride.
I mean, just, and he was just practically in
You're
tears.
Not riding
he
the
said,
carousel.
I swear it was zipper. I thought it was safe. And it's like, no, please read the signs and just empty your pockets.
Trust us when we tell you.
Well, and here's another thing too, aside from the fact that it's not safe. I mean, who's ever lost a phone? Okay, I just
I have.
Yeah. How it is the worst?
I'm not like yes. lost. I've broken.
It
a
is
lot
the
of
worst
them.
Feeling in because you have your it. Things on that, and it's kind of now it's an extension of you. So do yeah. yourself the favor, please, yeah. please do not bring it on the rides.
Right. Right.
Yes.
Lauren, did you have any?
Bring it down.
You got a squeak?
Oh, that was because I was like, man.
Leah saved that question.
Yeah, Leah.
No, ooh, Leah. Ooh. Leah nailed it. I really, Leah really don't know. It. Well, wait,
can you just
wait.
Tell us the winner?
Oh, I know. I know she already got it, but I do. Here we go. So, we live in a rural area, and the voyage is fenced in. You know, as we have to, but despite these fences, every now and then, wildlife get inside of the fence. And those little creatures are not, when they're not really little, they're deer. And they are not wanted on the voyage.
No.
So very good point.
Oh, Indiana.
Right. And we will shut down the ride to get them out.
Yes. Yeah. And same thing with Thunderbird. I remember I was,
yes.
who was I with? I think it was, European Coaster Club, Justin from the European Coaster Club. Oh, no. And he was taking pictures of Thunderbird because it was the first time he'd uh-huh. been to the park since we opened it. Mm-hmm. And so while he was taking pictures and I thought, well, I'm going to go ahead and do Facebook Live. And so we're back there and all of a sudden the ride, Thunderbird is not dispatching anymore. And it's like, oh no. And I'm here chattering away on stupid Facebook Live. Oh, I'm sure it'll be any second. We'll see another. Then I hear on the radio code WL, which yeah. WL means wildlife. Yes. Oh no. So I explained, and then I could actually see the deer from where I was. And sure enough, they had to get it out because Santa's reindeer can fly and they jump those fences.
Yep, they sure can.
Yeah.
So. And just so everyone knows, it's very safe. We yes. were constantly yes. monitoring yes. and we have very high fences around the coasters. But yes,
I was going to say, we had to adjust the fences though, yep. didn't we? Because yeah. we thought yep. we had an ideal height and the deer,
the deer proved us otherwise.
I have to say, yes. moving from the East Coast, coaster I couldn't addicts, believe you know, those deer. The number of deer that are around here. Yes. I mean, it's some kind of problem. Like, driving down the road and they're in the, you know, just walking yep. around. Well, where were we?
We've got like a pack of deer that live this at, like, summer. Right by mom's house.
Yep. Yeah. Oh,
the
yeah.
albino deer loves to hang out
oh,
there.
Oh, I do love that albino deer. No, but like I was walking by Kima Bay one summer day. It was like a normal summer day and there's a deer just trotting along the Midway and it's like, yep. get out of the Midway. Go to the woods. And they're not afraid. You know, they're not afraid
nope.
of people. Yeah. They're very friendly. They're just...
Yeah. I was driving home the other night. Of course, it turns to night at about 3:30 in the afternoon.
Seriously.
So no, horrible. When it was really foggy. And I'm driving home. Oh, it was yeah. Monday, which I think everybody was in a virtual fog most of Monday, yeah. just first day back after being off for so long. And I'm driving home and all of a sudden I see a deer by the side of the road, like through the fog. And I just wanted to slam on my brakes and go like 2 miles an hour the rest of the way home because I thought, yeah. where did you come you from? You yeah. were right there. Did you just cross in front of me and I didn't see you because of the fog? But
well, in the family, then yeah. there's one mm-hmm. behind
if
them.
If there's always. One, there's yes. five.
They're never
yeah.
alone.
They're never alone. Yeah. So that was a...
If one crosses in front of you, you best stop.
Yes. So I was able to make it home without any further
well, that's good.
Difficulty, thank goodness. But yeah, that kind of freaked me yeah. out. Be sure and join us in 2 weeks. Where we'll be back with the one with the wooden you like to know.
Oh,
thank
funny.
You to Stephen Rutherford for making us sound so good and for oh so carefully selecting the sound effect for the pop-up version of our mannequin video. Thanks to Lauren Hinkle, who, you may not know this, is our holla shopkeeper. She takes all those photos oh. and mm. writes all the descriptions and takes good care of the holla shop. And thanks to all of you for listening. Please subscribe to iTunes, Google Play Music, iHeartRadio, Stitcher, now even on YouTube, and tell all your friends, maybe even post a review. It's so such a beggy thing to do, but we've been stuck on iTunes. We've been stuck at, I think, 14 reviews. Oh, who'll
they
be
like
number 15?
They really like us.
On behalf of our pod squad, Lauren, Eric, Leah, and Absent Matt, Happy New Year and thank you. Please be sure absolutely. To send us your feedback and questions on social media using the hashtag HoWoHo.
Been listening to the official Holiday World podcast.
Welcome back. Did you enjoy your flight?
A production of Holiday World and Splash and Safari in Santa Claus, Indiana. Check out the latest episodes at holidayworld.com/podcast. Thanks for taking a ride with us.
And please come back to see us again soon.